بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أم الفضل، may Allah be pleased with her. Her name is Lubaba bint al-Harith al-Hilaliya. She is the wife of Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, the Prophet's uncle. She is also the sister of Maymuna, the mother of the faithful. May Allah be pleased with all of them. According to Ibn Sa'd, she was one of the first women who embraced Islam after Khadija. She and Maymuna had two other half-sisters, Asma and Salama, daughters of Umayyah. It was these four sisters that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam described as the believing sister. That was a commendation and what a great one. As for Umul Fazl, she had rules and intentions regarding the noble household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hence, rules and intentions relating to the call unto the way of Allah. Umul Fazl was a regular visitor of Khadija, and she would often meet with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and acquire the knowledge of religion from him. This is in addition to her ability to keep secret her fulfillment of covenant and her sincerity for the pure religion, in spite of her husband's farness from Islam, Iman, and his failure to join the cause of Dawah. She dealt with her husband as a mistress of the household and a dutiful wifehood, and she saw a wonder in him. Abbas sympathized with his nephew Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and defended him, though he was not yet a Muslim. Perhaps it was tribalism of the time of ignorance that spurred him to do so. On one hand, he would like to preserve his status that he inherited from Abu Talib among the Quraysh, and on the other hand, he would stand in support of his nephew, defending the kinship. Amid all this, Umul Fazl was expecting the decision of Allah concerning Abbas' acceptance of Islam, eagerly wishing that that would take place sooner. She was also hoping that he would stop eating up people's wealth unlawfully, for he used to be among those who dealt in usury. He was well known for that, as he was well known for his love for money. Umm Fazl was very astonished the day she saw Abbas witnessing the allegiance of Aqaba and having a say in the whole thing, as he was the guardian of his nephew. But she had the greatest surprise in her husband the day she saw him going out with the Quraysh to fight the Muslims during the Battle of Badr. She took a little rest when Abbas came back to Makkah after he was taken a captive by the Muslims and then released through the Prophet's favor. It was then that he felt the faith and Islam, and the light started creeping into his heart to remove the darkness that had been residing there. Then the household of Abbas stabilized and became perfectly harmonized. This is because every member of his household was now a Muslim. Umm al-Fadl had always been persuasive of Abbas' acceptance of Islam, though it was Allah who encompassed all of them from their behind. It was He who united them upon righteousness and honor. Umm al-Fadl was pleased to remain in Makkah and make herself and her house a place of refuge for the weak and the poor who could not afford to migrate and join the Muslims. It was as if these poor people were in a war with the enemies of Allah. Though they were denied the opportunity of meeting the enemy in the fields of physical war, they had been fighting a war of challenge and perseverance. Among the greatest days of Ummul Fazl and Abbas in their confrontation with the Quraysh was the day of the Battle of Khaybar, since Allah has given victory to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam over the Jews and Khaybar. And Khaybar was entirely conquered and the Muslims won its booty and treasure. Hadza ibn Alaq Sulami sought the Prophet's permission to go to Makkah and recover his money and debt owed to him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam permitted him to go, and he also permitted him to say whatever he wanted as a strategic way of making people allow him to get his right. Hajar came to Makkah and spread news among the people that the Jews had killed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and that the Muslims were roundly defeated. He also told them that many Muslims were killed and that many of their women and children were taken as captives. The Quraysh believed him. He then retrieved all his wealth and debt that people owed him and headed back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib accosted him on his way and asked him about the actual situation, for he was very concerned and sad about what he had said. Hajar told him the truth and requested him to keep the matter secret for 3 days, and Abbas promised to do so. Abbas was extremely happy about the truth that the Muslims won and that the Jews were defeated. He came back home and informed his wife Ummul Fazl about the matter and asked her to keep it a secret. After 3 days, Abbas came out in his best attire and, with the help of his wife, wore the best perfume. She was also in an exceptionally high spirit. Abbas went to the courtyard of Kaaba, where the people and the Quraysh leaders used to gather. When they saw him in his adornment and exuding perfume, they wanted to mock him. They said, "Is that how to show patience in the face of calamity, O Abul Fazl?" He did not give a hoot to their warning. He let them know the facts in full and how Ajaz had fooled them so that he could collect all his money and the debt people owed him, and that he had succeeded in doing so and escaped. Abbas then added, "What more? Muhammad, my nephew, is now the groom to the daughter of the Jewish king, Huyay ibn Akhtab." The news was like a storm to them, and they were stupefied. The news then kept trickling to them to confirm what Abbas had told them, and this increased them in grief and sorrow. Ummul Fazl remained in Makkah with her husband Abbas until after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Makkah in the company of his companion to perform the Umrah of Qadha, for which they stayed for 3 days in Makkah, he proposed marriage to Maymuna, Ummul Fazl's sister, and a widow whose husband, Abu Rahm ibn Abdul Huzza, died in the state of polytheism. She used to live in the house of her sister Ummul Fazl and under the protection of Abbas. All of them then left Makkah, and Abbas and Ummul Fazl migrated to Medina with their entire household. In Medina, Umm al-Fadl was a frequent visitor to the Prophet's house. She would either came to visit her sister Maimuna or any of the Prophet's wives. All knew her and acknowledged her excellence. One night, Umm al-Fadl had a dream and came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam seeking his opinion concerning the dream. She said, "Messenger of Allah, I saw it in my dream that a part of your body is in my house." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then answered her, "Fatima, my daughter, will give birth to a boy whom you will nurse with the milk of Futun," meaning her son. Dear reader, most of us would just make a passing reading of the event. If anything attracts one's attention, it would not be more than the interpretation of the dream popularly reported from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As regards the Prophet's saying "a boy," and with specification, this needs some introspection and reflection. This is in fact a manifestation of revelation and prophecy with which Allah endowed His trustworthy messenger and the seal of His Prophet, blessings and peace be upon him. Fatima gave birth to Hussein and Umm al-Fadl nursed him along with her son Qutb. When he was a few months old, she brought the boy to his grandfather sallallahu alaihi wasallam and sat him down in his lap. The boy urinated on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Umm al-Fadl smacked him between his shoulders. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then rebuked her, "You have hurt my son. May Allah have mercy on you." Umm al-Fadl entered the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from its widest door. She was a woman to keep an eye on in the Prophet's household, and she played an important role there. There are authentic narrations indicating her understanding of the religion of Allah. She performed the farewell pilgrimage with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and in the company of her husband Abbas and her children. What a great company and an honorable occasion. The honor was greater in that the occasion was the day of Arafat, when people were conjecturing on a matter they were unsure of. They were asking one another, "Is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam fasting or not?" Umm al-Fadl performed an outstanding deed to dispel this rumor when she took a vessel of milk and brought it to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who received it from her and drank it. The people then knew that he was not fasting. So those among his companions who were fasting broke it. There is no doubt that she had heard it before from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that it is not permissible for the pilgrim to fast on the day of Arafat. Thus, she dispelled the doubt of those who were doubtful through her knowledge and deeds. It is enough a pride for Umm al-Fadl radiallahu anha and a memory throughout generations that she was the mother of Abdullah ibn Abbas, the learned of the Ummah, the interpreter of the Quran, and the scholar among the companions. May Allah be pleased with her and please her. May He also be pleased with all the companions.